Coming up, if you're in a highly regulated industry and want to innovate with the cloud, we're going to meet with one of the world's leading international banks, HSBC, to learn how. And we're going to explore how they built an intelligent, secure, and analytics-rich digital payment platform for their PayMe for Business app in Hong Kong on Azure. And to do that, I'm joined today by Alessio Basso, Chief Architect of PayMe from HSBC. Welcome.
Thanks for having me on the show.
Thank you. So congrats on the recent launch of HSBC's PayMe for Business app. And also, we're looking forward to really hearing a lot from you today in terms of how you've built it. Now, I know that HSBC is really one of the largest banks in the world, and it's strategically done a lot of work in terms of educating regulators and in the financial services sector really about the benefits of cloud and how it can be used to store data securely. Not only has HSBC been a thought leader, but it's also really led by example in terms of how to harness and be the first mover in terms of going to the cloud.
Yes, we've taken a pretty progressive mindset in terms of our technology strategies. We know that regulations are important in order to make sure that everybody in the industry adheres to the same check and balances. But this regulation should not hold us back, should not prevent us from continuing innovating for our customers. We know that we need to have, and we do have, good strategies in terms of information security and risk management, and we can deliver on those strategies with the tools that the cloud give us today.
Right. So, but HSBC, given its global footprint, must have a lot of legacy on-premises data centers and operations, right?
We do. We have over 39 million customers around 66 countries and territories. So we have a pretty massive footprint. We operate our own data centers in 21 of those countries. Our goal, though, is to be fully on cloud within the next 5 to 10 years, adopting a mobile-first business approach. This, of course, is important in places like Hong Kong, where the majority of the population owns more than two devices, so everybody does everything on their mobile phone. And of course, this gives us the opportunity to rethink the banking experience and the services that we deliver to our customers.
Right, and in Hong Kong, especially, and even the rest of Asia, you see a lot of people are really opting to just carry their phones with them without having to bring cash or maybe their wallets. It's really gotten more convenient in terms of making payments just from their mobile devices.
That's right. This was the motivation for the PayMe for Business app that I'm going to walk you through today. But we actually started first by supporting cashless in a P2P fashion. HSBC PayMe app for consumers was launched in early 2017. You can think of it as a social payment application that allows you to send money to your friends and family without asking for their phone number or for their bank account, all for free. And the app is used widely among people in Hong Kong to share money in social situations, like when you go out with friends and share a meal or you do an activity together. And we have now more than 1.5 million people using it in Hong Kong.
It's about 6 million population in Hong Kong. So about 1 in 5 people are already using HSBC's PayMe app. And it really gives you a great customer base to get started with in terms of applying this to merchants so that they can make payments as they shop and buy other consumables.
It does. Actually, PayMe for Business application allows businesses to collect payments in real time. And that's unlike traditional payment methods like credit card.
Right, which those can take a few days.
Absolutely. Right? With PayMe for Business, you have access to the money you collect in real time, anytime you want. And we, of course, taking advantage of all the bank-grade security that HSBC provides. On top of that, it's fast for the consumer. 98% of our transaction terminates within 500 milliseconds. Mm-hmm. And we have built-in intelligence so that the business can use data to analyze the sales trend and, you know, have ideas on how to grow their business even further. On top of that, big companies can also use us. We have API that you can integrate, for instance, if you have an e-commerce website or if you have a POS device. So we cover really the whole spectrum of merchants in Hong Kong.
So it sounds like a great app and a lot of people are using it. Why don't we dig into the architecture of how you built it?
Of course. So the app is a cloud-native application, and our first decision was to develop using a microservice-based architecture. So the app consists of a dozen or so microservices, mm-hmm. each one performing a different function. For instance, we have our user and business profile services. Mm-hmm. We have an onboarding microservice that you call when you register to the service for the first time. We have payments, transaction and reporting to perform payments and get information about those. We have a security authentication microservice, which tells you the level of authentication that you need to do to perform different functions within the app.
Makes sense.
On top of that, we also have social. Think about managing the interaction between people and people and people and merchants. Mm-hmm. We do have a timeline service that serves, of course, the list of your transaction, but also insights. We do have a notification service that takes care of push notification, email, SMS, or whatever else.
Right.
We have a QR code service, and we do have an OCR service, which is used when you register for the service. We ask the customer to take a picture of his or her Hong Kong ID. So we used to extract data from the Hong Kong ID. On top of that, we also have FAQ and messages, which are related to the in-app support feature of the application, where you can contact the support people chatting inside the app.
Okay, so those are all the services, and they're all waiting to be called then in the event of a transaction?
Yes, they are. Let me guide you through a typical transaction,
okay.
Right? So when the merchant wants to collect a payment, he or she types the amount on the app,
mm-hmm.
and the app called the QR code payment service. The QR code service generates a representation of the transaction that's displayed on the device of the merchant. Then the consumer takes his PayMe for Consumer app, scans the QR code, and the details of the payment are displayed on the screen for confirmation.
Okay.
You can confirm by fingerprint or Face ID, and then you call the payment transaction microservice that processes the transaction. After that, of course, the notification service sent a notification to the consumer as well as the merchant. And when the merchant gets the confirmation, that the consumer can walk out of the shop with the goods.
Cool. So we just walk through all the different services, kind of interact as part of the payment process. But do each of these microservices then run independently from one another?
They certainly do. Actually, we designed them to be specifically independent. Each microservice is independent and is also having its own copy or its own instance of each of the Azure services that it's using. For instance, a microservice may have an Azure database for MySQL service to store data. It has its own copy of Key Vault, Redis Cache, Azure Event Hub, and so on and so forth. This level of isolation is helping us on two factors. First is it makes it easier to reason about security, you know, where everything is isolated.
Right.
And it also helps us increase the uptime of the application. If the microservice or any of the depending services have an issue, only the functions that are provided by them microservices become unavailable. So the app and the rest of the other function keep working as usual.
But it's probably pretty rare that something goes down, right?
That said, it's very rare that something goes down.
Right, right. So we just talked about how the microservices then help in terms of resiliency and really being independent from one another. But do they actually help in terms of scaling out when you have more demand on the service?
They do, they do. For instance, we have certain period of the year where we have more traffic, like the Chinese New Year festivities, when people go out more or they like to send gifts.
Right.
To each other. In these periods, we scale out services like the payment transaction services, but we don't have to scale out much other services like the onboarding services.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, we can scale not only the compute layer, but also the database layer. We can create read replicas of the MySQL databases, and we can serve the read-only queries as well as the analytical queries from the read replicas without impacting the main database.
So no impact then in terms of performance on the main transacting side, but have you perf tested this and load tested this, how many transactions you can actually perform?
We did. We went up to 500 million transactions per day in our test, so we're pretty confident that we can handle these peaks.
Wow. So I saw also in the earlier architecture view, you're using Azure Key Vault really for secrets management. How do the services then securely communicate with one another?
Right. So each microservice runs within its own subnet, and they all communicate with Azure services like database or cache or storage using service principles and credentials that we put in Key Vault. We also use VNet service endpoints, which is a feature of Azure services that make managed services that typically run in the cloud somewhere and they're managed look like a local endpoint within your own VNet. So from the point of view of the microservice, it's a local call to an endpoint that exists
right.
within the same VNet.
And that's great because even though you might have some services in the cloud and some in local data centers, they all look like they're on the same network.
They do. And this capability is critical in our security design. For instance, think about that. In the cloud, everything is public and every service has a publicly accessible endpoint on the internet. Mm-hmm. And it's critical that all the communication are authenticated and encrypted. The traditional view on-prem is that you have a secure perimeter and then everything inside this perimeter is secure. With VNet Service Endpoint, we get the best of both worlds. We still adopt the secure model of the cloud to connect every transactions, but we can talk to services as if they're all within the same secure perimeter.
Right, and this really helps, especially when you think of security teams, if they've got perspectives maybe where they want to lock down everything within the perimeter so that resources that are internal are deemed safe, but maybe not the external sources. This way it all looks like it's internal. Now, what are you doing in terms of controlling traffic coming in and out of the subnets?
So we use a network security group, and we have a base rule that denies all inbound or outbound traffic from our VNet. And this way, we can add additional rules to explicitly allow inbound or outbound traffic from or to IP that we know we have to communicate with. And this gives us an extra layer of security and confidence that we are allowing only the traffic that's supposed to be there. The other thing that we do is that we automate the deployment of these rules as well as of the services and everything that's related to the application. Mm-hmm. So we completely remove the insider risk or the human error risk from the picture.
Right, so these are all security measures, effectively blocking all the traffic that you don't want, making sure that you automate. What about threat modeling? Are you doing something there as well proactively?
Yeah, we do. It's part of our risk management process. So we identify the possible risks, and then we have to identify and implement mitigations for this risk. One thing that makes our life easier is that there are features in some of the Azure services to make this process easier for us. For instance, there are features like advanced threat protection in Azure Database for MySQL that already monitor for events that are associated with some particular risks and raise an alert if any of these events happen. Let me show you that how we do it. The other day, I got an email notification, like the one that you see on the screen here, and it says an unfamiliar principal successfully logged onto the server. Mm-hmm. This means that a user credential that we have was used to connect to that particular database from a location that was not an usual one. So I told you that every microservice is isolated, so that database expects connections only from all the instances of that particular microservice.
Right.
In case we have a connection coming in from somewhere else, this is an unusual situation that's automatically flagged for us for investigation.
So how do you enable this then to actually start working?
Yeah, so when you go to the panel, the database, you select the database server, for instance, the business profile database. And when you go here, you see that advanced threat protection, in my case, it's enabled. And that's the switch that you have to flip. So when you flip the switch on, then this email is notified when something unusual happens.
Right, right. And also, you can also view those alerts from inside Azure Security Center. Now, you're also able to protect things like microservices, their data, monitor activity within the network. But why don't we talk about the analytics platform and switch gears a little bit? What have you done there?
Yeah, for us, the analytic and the data part in particular is key. PayMe started as a social P2P application where transactions were the main focus. And in reality, though, we discovered that the application is useful because of the network that the participants on the platform create,
right.
Like people communicating to another people or a person paying a merchant. So we took all the transactional data and we put it in the graph data model using Cosmos. And that's what we use as our analytic and store. On top of that, we use Databricks as our data platform that we use to stitch together all this data interaction. And we use that to perform both data engineering workload as well as data science workloads.
And how does this help then serve the customer? So if you're a merchant or a consumer, how do you benefit from some of this stuff?
Right. So one example is that we monitor interaction on the platform to spot suspicious sequences and then either alert the customer or do corrective actions. The way we do it is that we streamline a lot of the data that we have in all our different data stores We have transactional data stores, we have Event Hub, we have storage into Databricks. And when in Databricks, we refine this data. So we ingest raw and then we move it to a clear staging model, we call it, until the data that's connected together is ending up in the graph format into what we call SLIM, which stands for Simple Lightly Integrated Model. And that's the base that our data scientists use to run their models.
So is this process then to get it into basically that conversion a batch, or is it a real-time process?
We try to make it as fast as possible. So some of those data is actually ingested. Mm-hmm. Some is processed in place. Just to give you an example, the clickstream data that we get to measure user interaction in the app mm-hmm. is ingested directly into Event Hub, and then it goes into Azure Storage, and then we don't move it from there. We access it from Databricks, mm-hmm. So we can perform SQL queries on that, but the actual data never leaves storage. So
you don't need to move the data. It stays in its normal place.
Yeah, for some of the sources. Okay. Like an ETL without the transfer.
Right. So it's more efficient because you're getting a remote view effectively into the data, so it's virtualized.
Correct. Yeah.
Very, very cool. So how about cases where it's not real time in nature? What do you do there?
Yeah. One case, for example, that is not real time is the transaction classification. We want to mm-hmm. Understand what our user use the platform for so that we can provide new services to them. For instance, let's say that we take a taxi together and we have to share the fare. You send me a payment message and you type taxi from Kowloon to Hong Kong.
Right.
So from there, we can identify and classify this payment as a transit or a transport payment. And we do the same for a number of other categories. The way we do it, let me show you. As I mentioned, we do both data engineering and data science workloads on Databricks. Mm-hmm. So the workload here is a notebook. When you can see here, there are, you know, I walk you through the steps. The first step is importing libraries. The data scientists can import all the machine learning libraries that you're used to. And then here we do a bit of data engineering, which is we load the data, so that's available for the notebook to process. Mm-hmm. And then we do all the usual steps that you may expect when you do transaction classification. So we analyze the text, we remove numbers from the token. We also look at emoji, you can see here. So if you have a bowl of rice, that classifies as,
it helps to classify data.
It does. And after we identify L1 and L2 topics, then we save it on Delta, and then we display it on dashboard, like the one that I can show you here.
So then you can visualize some of the work that you've done there.
Correct. So you see here on top of the screen, you have the L1 categories for the use cases, mm-hmm. And then we have stats and numbers, and this will help us identify what the platform is used for, so we can focus on providing features specifically for that particular use case.
This is really great stuff because it's going to actually allow you to make app decisions in terms of improvements that you might want to make in the future. But can you share some tips maybe with the folks watching how they would build out something similar for their environments today?
Sure. There are really lessons learned from our experience. The first one is we use managed services because with our limited and small team, we could focus on the application and to solving problems from our customers. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have to spend effort in managing the infrastructure. And this is what allowed us to go from ideation to live in just a few months.
Right. That's a big deal. So go on PaaS services when you can, so you don't have to spend as much time managing servers and just managing your code and building your app.
Right. And the second thing is when we're designing your architecture, this isolation concept that each microservice is isolated helps you to reason on security, but also it helps increasing your availability.
These are really great tips. Thanks for joining us today, Alessio. Also, if you want to check out HSBC's PayMe app, you can learn more at the link shown. If you're in Hong Kong, you can sign up for it, start using it today. If you're not using it already, that's all the time we have for today's show, coming to you from the Microsoft Technology Center in Bellevue, Washington. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.